morning, everyone. Good morning. We are again thrilled that we are back all to the ADC Business Breakfast Roundtable on every Thursday, third Thursday of every month. And my name is Hussein Samatar with African Development Center, along with my colleagues, Rhoda, Liban, Matthew, and Anya is here this morning. Thank you, Anya, for being here. Sarah is also here, and all the staff that made this project available. Also, good morning, Ron. All of you, welcome to the program. We are truly thrilled today because we are intersecting health, economic development, poverty, and the continent of Africa. Excitement is we have a Dr. Christy Hanson, who is coming from Macalester College, as a college that we have had a relationship for a long time, and we are really, truly thrilled that she's here and will be speaking to you today, and hopefully you will gain some insights of her work and what is happening around health and the continent of Africa. So again, we have had amazing ADC, first ADC Business Breakfast Roundtable on last Friday, September 14th. I hope you will all come and go online on our Facebook website and YouTube channel and see the work that has been done on last Friday. Also, we are in the process of doing research around culture and economic development and business. And if you see Sarah Larson around, please help her out. So now, to Dr. Christy Hanson, we are again thrilled this morning you to be here. She really comes with a long, long resume, but I'll try to do her justice and give you a summary of who she is before she comes on and speaks to you this morning. And Dr. Christy Hanson is the Dean of the Institute for Global Citizenship and Senior Lecturer in the International Studies Department at Macalester College. Dr. Hanson was the Hubert H. Humphrey Professor of International Studies during 2011-2012 and fought Introduction to International Public Health and Poverty, Health and Development with nearly 20 years of experience in this field. She provided technical support to countries in Africa, Asia, Latin America through previous positions that she had, one of which was the World Health Organization, World Bank, BATH, the United States Agency for International Development, USAID. Dr. Hanson has also published on economic burden of neglected tropic diseases and the impact that they have on people and economy. As you can imagine, without education and health, no economy will move forward. Dr. Hanson received her MPH from the University of Minnesota and her PhD in international health systems with concentration in health economics from Johns Hopkins University. And Dr. Hanson does independent research, focuses on, again, as I said it, the dynamics and the relationship of poverty, healthcare seeking behavior. Now, as you know, the African Development Center is all about the community of Africa here in the state, but also as well as the global community. We are thrilled, Dr. Hanson, to shed a light on that relationship. Thank you very much. However you want to do.
Thank you. Good morning. Thank you so much for having me. It's really a pleasure to get to engage with such a community here in Minnesota. I'm a new import to Minnesota, so it's really a treat for me to see how active this group has been with the African community in Minnesota and to raise awareness and interest in economic development and growth on the continent of Africa. So today I'm going to talk a bit about the relationship between health and healthcare systems and poverty and economic growth and development, primarily in sub-Saharan Africa. I'll touch a bit on Northern Africa, but primarily in sub-Saharan Africa. I'm going to start, actually, I'll toggle over to an active map in a moment, but what I'm going to focus on here is trying to just demonstrate graphically the relationship between economics or the economy as indicated by GDP per person, so gross domestic product per person, which is along the axis, the horizontal axis along the bottom, and life expectancy, which is on the vertical axis. Each of the bubbles on the graph represents a country, and the size of the bubble demonstrates the population in the country. So the larger bubbles are more populous countries, larger populations. The small bubbles are smaller countries in terms of population. So if you could toggle over to the interactive map. So what you're going to notice here is that if you look at the world map up in the upper right-hand corner, you can see that the countries in sub-Saharan Africa are colored blue, and those in northern Africa yellow. So you can follow. We're going to start in 1920. And I want you to just take a look at the economic growth and the changes in life expectancy from 1920 until today. You can go ahead and hit play. And this will just take a minute to move through. But what you see in orange, that's the European and former Soviet states. Yellow, North and South America. Red being Asia. And what you're starting to see is what started as a clump of the world kind of on similar terms. We start to see a lot of regional disaggregation and clustering. And so, unfortunately, what you see in blue in the lower quadrant are some of the countries in sub-Saharan Africa where you've got a combination of lower life expectancies. So if this is somewhat small, let's see if there's I don't think there's a pointer on here. The red button is a pointer. Okay, so life expectancy is around 50 to 55 years in many countries in sub-Saharan Africa, that being kind of the average, and income per person at around $1,000. Compared to some countries, this is the United States over in yellow here, with a per capita adjusted for inflation, this is the purchasing power parity estimation, at around $40,000 and life expectancy closer to 75. Now the relationship between income per person and life expectancy is a very complicated one. It goes both ways and it's very complex and lots of layers in there. But it is important just to take a look at the essentially linear relationship. When you've got an economy that has more money in it, you can imagine you can invest in infrastructure, you can invest in healthcare, you can invest in preventative tools, people may have better food to eat. There are lots and lots of things that a more robust economy does for its population and what it reflects. At the same time, when you've got people who are living in poor health, they cannot participate actively in the economy, even on an individual level or a community level. So the relationship goes both ways and it's very complex. I'm going to go back to the PowerPoint for a minute. So when we really tease apart how important different causes are, different health issues are to that life expectancy difference, and we try to understand why are people in sub-Saharan Africa dying younger than people in the United States? What accounts for that gap? Just from a health perspective, what accounts for that gap? And in 2000, the World Bank did some work and determined that about 77% of the deaths that were early, somewhere between that 50 and 75 range, that those early mortality numbers come from communicable diseases, infectious diseases, diseases like malaria, HIV, tuberculosis. So if from a health perspective, we wanted to close that life expectancy gap, we would want to focus on this set of diseases that really are driving this disparity between the poorest countries and the wealthiest countries. If you could go back for a minute to the other map. I'm going to show you a little bit how this plays out. So we're going to take the case of South Africa and Kenya, two very different countries in terms of their economic development and growth, but both countries that were hit pretty hard by the HIV epidemic. We're going to go back to 1980. So Kenya, 1979. So we're going to go back, and if you'd hit play here, and watch their economic development and life expectancy from 1980 to today. So do you see that for both countries, the life expectancy curves came way down, and what had been a trajectory of growth kind of stopped, right? So They're on the GDP per capita, they're almost vertical. There was almost no growth during that period that HIV was had really taken hold and was driving down life expectancy, was wreaking havoc on economies, on individuals' ability to contribute. As the HIV epidemic as antiretrovirals have rolled out and we've been able to improve the life expectancy of people living with HIV and AIDS, we're starting to see, with both Kenya and South Africa, it's slight, but we're starting to see some movement on the GDP per capita. Not that those are the only factors. There's lots and lots happening in the countries, but it is an important relationship to take note of. Okay, we'll go back to PowerPoint and I'll stop the toggling and we'll just stick with the PowerPoint now. So I want to take the case of tuberculosis, which is one of the infectious diseases, and very important in sub-Saharan Africa for a couple of reasons. One is we just took a look at a couple of case studies of the HIV epidemic and what it does to GDP and life expectancy. Tuberculosis is actually the primary cause of death of people living with HIV. So when people die from HIV, it's more than likely from tuberculosis, in fact. About half of the population in sub-Saharan Africa is infected with tuberculosis, about half. We'll talk about how TB starts to manifest itself in a minute. But if you take a look at the world map and you look, the darker shades are the countries, the darker shades of green are countries that have higher burdens of tuberculosis. And look across sub-Saharan Africa. Plagued. I mean, we're talking about prevalence rates of more than 300 per 100,000 people with active TB at any given time. So really, the sub-Saharan continent has really been plagued. In 2010, the last year for which we have data from all of the countries, there were 2.3 million new cases of tuberculosis that emerged in a single year in sub-Saharan Africa, not including Northern Africa, that led to 250,000 deaths in people without HIV. That doesn't even count the people who had HIV and died from TB. That's just in the HIV negative population. It's a funny thing that we do in public health that anyone who dies from HIV, no matter what the cause, we count it as an HIV death. So this is only TB deaths in people who are HIV negative. So when you take that map that we just looked at and you try to pare it down to low-income countries versus wealthy countries, you really see that in terms of the percent of deaths due to TB and even just the disability associated with TB, TB is disproportionately affecting the poorest countries in the world. And that also speaks to why it has been long neglected on the international stage. Because it's not in the United States or high-income countries, you see TB occasionally in the extremely marginalized or in the elderly populations whose immune systems are extremely compromised. So it's something that many, many people, and I saw some surprised looks around the room when I said that half of sub-Saharan Africa has TB infection. A lot of people in high-income countries assume that TB has been eliminated, has been eradicated, is no longer a big problem, is very, very rare, when in fact it's a major, major driver of economic loss. So I want to just spend a couple of seconds talking to you a little bit medically, clinically about TB and how it manifests. So people get exposed to TB when somebody else with TB coughs and someone can breathe it in. So it's an infectious disease, a communicable disease through coughing. Once someone is exposed, the infection becomes latent in their body. And for those of us, probably everyone sitting in this room, pretty well nourished, access to healthcare, not living in overcrowded conditions, you harbor that TB infection. You may harbor it your entire life as latent infection, and it will never break down to TB disease. But TB can break down into active disease and does break down into active disease when the body is taxed. So pregnancy that is can cause some hormonal changes and a real change in the immune system can provoke the emergence of TB, which could happen to a person in this country. But pregnancy tends to be more taxing when there's not a lot of spacing between births and the type of thing that may happen in lower income settings. HIV obviously compromising the immune system. Malnutrition is a very important contributor to the breakdown to TB disease. Indoor residual smoke, so people cooking with wood or dung or this kind of thing in enclosed environments, which happens in a lot of rural areas, a lot of communities in sub-Saharan Africa, really compromises the lungs and allows TB to emerge. So what you start to see when you start thinking about TB is that there are poverty-related risk factors all along the way. So people who are living in impoverished conditions may be living in really crowded conditions. If you think of some of the urban, really packed urban settings, across sub-Saharan Africa and the slum areas within them. People are living on top of each other. So the infection, the spread of disease is quite profound. Then if they're not well nourished, if birth spacing is close, and HIV is present, you can see that the breakdown to TB disease just becomes much more rampant. And it doesn't take long before you have, you know, a couple of cases packed into those impoverished types of conditions with crowding and no nutrition and immune systems being compromised for the disease to break down, and then it spreads, and those people break down and it spreads, and you start to see why you've got such massive rates of prevalence. And so underlying it all on the continent of Africa, at the end of the day, we've got about half of people infected, and the real priority now is to not allow those people to break down to disease, which means we've got to address the underlying poverty. So just in terms of thinking about it kind of from a grandiose perspective or an economic development perspective, you've got this terrible cycle where the poor individuals and poor communities may lack food security. They lack income stability, access to water, sanitation, all of those types of things, and access to healthcare, which is a really important thing we'll talk about in a minute, which can provoke the breakdown of, from TB infection to TB disease. And once they get TB disease, usually they will, an individual patient will seek care, will pay for transport, will pay fees to get access to care, may not go to a place that offers the right kind of care. There have been studies and studies and studies and studies looking at the economic impact of TB on individuals and on households. And across sub-Saharan Africa, on average, it's about 20 to 30% of annual wages will go to care seeking for a given individual in a household. So among poor families, that is catastrophic. And we do, in fact, call it a catastrophic expenditure. A lot of social stigma, job loss. If you're working at all in the corporate sector in Africa, there are not always the protective policies, labor protection policies, and so people can be and are fired for having tuberculosis. Also, they just are often too sick to work. And of course, breakdown to full HIV or AIDS. So this is not going to be something that's surprising to most of you, but when we start thinking about how are we going to address something like tuberculosis in some of the countries in sub-Saharan Africa, we're talking about countries with very limited infrastructure in some cases. This is a map from Zambia, just illustrative, showing the districts, the availability of electricity. And this is from 2004, and things have changed. Infrastructure is changing, but probably not quickly enough. So you look at the majority of the districts are colored yellow, which means that fewer than 50% of health facilities or clinics in those districts have electricity. Well, you can't detect TB without a microscope. You need electricity to run most of the microscopes, or a generator, or a solar-powered something, or, you know, which just starts adding cost and complexity and breakdown and all of this kind of thing. And it also speaks to the sophistication of the clinic. So if you've got clinics without electricity, you probably aren't attracting trained physicians to those clinics. It's pretty hard to work under those conditions. So you're lucky if you've got a nurse, and probably more likely you have kind of a health officer who has minimal clinical training and may not recognize TB. So you've got the majority of the population living in areas, or the majority of the geography, being places where really when we start trying to implement services through the formal health sector, it becomes very challenging because we don't have the infrastructure that's available. This is also just looking, like I mentioned, it's hard to attract high-level trained physicians to areas without even electricity. This is looking at the distribution of health providers in Zambia. The dark colored areas are the districts where there's at least two health providers per 1,000 population. Very, very few areas of the country where you get that. And that's any type of trained health provider, not doctors necessarily. So when we start thinking about TB, you know, there's this universe of TB cases that we believe are out there. Maybe there aren't as many cases as we really think, but it's a smaller number that actually make it to a health facility, an even smaller number that make it to a health facility that may have the right drugs, the right diagnostic tools, all of that. Even smaller number that get to a place where somebody's been trained to detect TB and does it properly. Even smaller that get diagnosed appropriately, even smaller that get the right treatment. And so you start to see where are the missing cases when we think about why do we have this massive spread of TB and why can't we contain it? And it's very easy to see that when you don't have the infrastructure and individuals don't have the resources to get to health systems, how quickly the system can break down and we can be left with a pool of cases who are somehow outside of the system. So now I want to talk a little bit about the Kenyan context specifically. And this is some work that I did with the government about 10 years ago. And I'm excited to share it with you because I was just back in Kenya in May doing kind of the next wave of planning together with the government. And there's just been enormous progress. So this is kind of telling a success story, but explaining also the complexity of poverty. So the health infrastructure, the health system in Kenya, is very appropriately designed to its population. This 62% of health facilities are what are called dispensaries, which are very simple clinics at the ruralmost areas, very accessible to rural local populations. And so they really have organized the health system with referral hospitals in urban centers, but massive numbers of these smaller clinics out in rural areas where the population lives. When we look at the percent of all of those public facilities that participate in TB control, meaning that they have TB drugs in stock and on their shelves, somebody in the clinic's been trained on detecting TB, they have some place to send a sample to get a diagnosis. We saw, this was, like I said, about 10 years ago, that really the government had focused on equipping the hospitals and the health centers, the higher level health centers. It's a little easier to get at those places and to train them. They have doctors and lots of equipment. And really only about 12% of the dispensaries that are actually out in the rural level were equipped to deal with TB, even knowing what a TB case looks like and referring it or having the drugs available. You start to look at that mismatch and it starts becoming a little bit clear that if you've got your rural populations being more likely to be poor, just the demographics in Kenya, less access to transport, the infrastructure issues. If you haven't brought the services to them, then you're expecting the patients to get to the services where the services are, and that would seem to be a problem. However, at the time, the government really felt strongly, the central level of the government said, but TB patients are really, really sick, which they are. They get really, really sick over time. You let them stay sick long enough, they get really, really sick. And so there was a perception that because the hospitals were full of TB patients and the health centers were full of TB patients, there was a perception, well, these guys are so sick, they're choosing to make the trip to Nairobi or the trip to Mombasa to go to a hospital. We don't think they're out there at the rural level. We think they're choosing to come to the hospitals. And that's why we focus there. They really thought that they do that because there was so much stigma at the time related to tuberculosis, because it looks a lot like HIV. People with TB cough, they lose weight, they have night sweats. It looks a lot like HIV, which is highly stigmatized. So there was also a perception that people didn't want to be diagnosed or treated near their communities, and so they would travel to these higher level facilities. They also were saying, you know, the TB patients we're seeing in these hospitals are poor. These are poor people who we're seeing, so we're not missing the poor. They're coming to our hospitals, so you know we're capturing them. That's not the problem. And they also felt that the TB patients, because they're poor, they would use the public sector. TB care is free in the public sector. And there was a sense that they wouldn't go to the private sector, because in the private sector health providers charge for services. And so there was a broad perception that the poor would go where the services are free. And we agreed, because Kenya at the time was only detecting about half of the TB cases that we knew was in the country. And they were just bashing their heads saying, we don't understand why we're only getting half of these patients. We're doing everything. We're training all these people. We've got drugs. We're rolling out labs. And so we actually agreed to explore where are your missing cases. So we did a lot of research all over the country. And we developed a tool for determining who is poor, which is not an easy thing to do in many settings because people don't have a formal income, so you can't just say how much money do you make. It's very complicated. But we developed a matrix to determine who is poor, and we actually found that the poorest 20% of the population were spending more in real terms seeking care because the services were not available to them where they needed them. They didn't have information about where to go. And so they were spending so much money. They were spending more than the relatively rich in seeking care for their illness. They were spending, on average, $30 US which, if you know income levels in some rural sub-Saharan Africa, that's a lot of money. They were spending on average $30 before even getting diagnosed with tuberculosis, the poorest TB patients. And TB care is supposed to be free in the public sector. So this was a shock to the government. So when we actually were able to research and understand where were these poor, the poorest people going for their care, it blew the government hypothesis out of the water, because really what we found is that the poor were using the public and the private sector almost equally. There was really high utilization of the private sector. So suddenly a whole, like half of the health sector that had not been a focus of attention became a really important part of the puzzle. Also, we noticed that just like anyone in the United States, the first thing you do when you have a cough is go to the pharmacy and try to get cough syrup. And that most people with tuberculosis would go repeatedly to pharmacies to try to get care. So what became very apparent is that the focus on the hospitals and the health centers was not meeting patients where patients needed to be met, and that there could be ways, rather than changing patient behavior, there were ways that the government could, with minimal infrastructure requirements — the infrastructure was there, it was just the utilization of that infrastructure and how to engage with the private sector and how to bring in pharmacies and how to train and equip the lower levels of the public system — there were ways to use the existing infrastructure to much better serve the populations where the populations needed it. And so in fact, that's exactly what the government did. They changed the modalities, and they spent the next 5 years rolling out services through the private sector to more decentralized health facilities. And in fact, when I was back this year, what we were looking at — so this is about the time, 2000 is about the time that we completed our study, which was kind of the low point in terms of case detection, where they were at about 50-some percent of the total estimated cases in the country. And they started to introduce these changes that would better reach the poorest of the population. And you see what has steadily happened from 2000 until today. They were actually the first country in sub-Saharan Africa to reach global targets for case detection. They reached them a few years ago. And the really encouraging part of the story is that now we're actually seeing that with improved treatment, and we're finding these patients in rural area, that transmission chain has been broken. And we're starting to see annual incidence of TB in Kenya going down. So even though there's still HIV, even though there's still poverty, even though there's still malnourishment, even though there's even more food insecurity, by dealing with the problem as just a simple health problem, just as a public health problem, we're seeing incidence go down. And of course, this is enabling huge numbers of people to be active in their families, active in their communities, active in the economy, and contribute to the labor force. So it is an important contributor when we're thinking about business, economic growth, development, societal engagement in Kenya. This is looking at kind of another way that is evolving now. All of the GIS, the mapping, and all of these technologies were not nearly as available when we did this research as they are today. One of the great things about all of this technology and the mobile technology is now we're starting to assess, when we look at health systems and access to care and these things, we can map them. And so this is a map from Uganda that looks at where are TB facilities, and you can just visually see where there are big gaps. And so when you start thinking about, well, a corporation wants to go in and hire the population that's in this region, well, if I were that corporation, I would be really wondering, where are these people going to get care? And I'm going to have some real issues. I better set up a clinic in my factory or whatever. So now I want to spend just a couple minutes talking about development assistance for health. Because oftentimes what's happening in countries in sub-Saharan Africa is there's simply not enough money in the government coffers, or there isn't the political will to make the investments in the social sectors to fully address some of the issues. So there's development assistance, donor money, coming in to a lot of the countries. And the ideals — I'm not saying that this is always the reality, but the ideals of the development assistance is to complement the national government funding, to promote the government ownership and leadership of these social sectors, to kind of stimulate the progress and the success so that the governments get excited about investing in them themselves, and investments within broad strategic frameworks, so to promote sustainability of new interventions. Like the Kenyan case, I did that work while I was with the World Bank, and Kenya had a grant. Fortunately, we were able to convert it from a loan to a grant for HIV. And so this was some work done under that auspice. And now, of course, the Kenyan government is, they have a vision for 2030 to have all donors out of the country. And it's brilliant. You watch this kind of progress and you can see where the government is picking up based on a kind of a tipping point. When we look, though, at total development assistance, so this is pooling all of the donors together, and you look at where are donors investing compared to where is their heavy disease burden. So the DALI is a measure of how heavy is the disease burden kind of on people, how much does it affect their livelihoods and their ability to contribute, their disability. And you can see the green, this is the scale, if you can't see it well, is from $0 per DALI on the top down to, you know, above $35 per DALI. And so you look at sub-Saharan Africa, and there are a couple of countries that get some that have a lot of donor interest. But you look at most of the countries, and they're really getting pretty minimal development assistance compared to the burden of disease in those countries, which means that the governments themselves are shouldering a lot of the costs and the progress, and are directly responsible for the progress that's being made, which we'll also talk about in a minute. So I wanted to just take the case of HIV, going back to HIV, and show this is the trend from 1990 to 2008 in terms of the amount of money that's flowing from donors into countries. And I took the case of HIV because the majority of this money is going into sub-Saharan Africa. So this is development assistance for HIV flowing into countries. So lots and lots of money going into health. A really key driver of the change in investments and the amount of money flowing into sub-Saharan Africa for infectious diseases, in particular AIDS, TB, and malaria, is the Global Fund, which some of you may be familiar with, which is it's an international partnership. It's kind of a pooled funding mechanism. And the unique nature of the Global Fund is that it's entirely demand-driven. Countries put forward proposals to the Global Fund with no limit set on what they can apply for. They just have to demonstrate technical excellence, technical relevance, and a well-articulated budget, and they can receive the funding from the Global Fund. So since 2002, when the Global Fund was founded, they've committed more than $22 billion to 150 countries. And you can see that the results in terms of their impact on those diseases. But then you wonder, what are the governments themselves doing? As donors are ramping up and trying to increase the investments in health and in social sectors, what are the disease endemic countries, the low-income countries, doing? And in fact, this is some monitoring done by a health metrics group at the University of Washington in Seattle. And they've been tracking government expenditures. And as you can see, there's been an overall, this is globally, there's been an overall increase in government investment in health. There's been a recognition that health is a key driver of economic development. This is a fairly new recognition, in fact, by many governments. And so there's been more investment in health and in education and the social sectors. But if you look at the purple graphs here, these are the sub-Saharan African countries, broken down the different shades of purple: west, south, east, central. But what's really pretty disappointing to me is if you look at these purple compared to other regions of the world, the governments themselves have not, in sub-Saharan Africa, have not really been investing much more in health. But the debate right now in the public health circles is that what's really happening is that donor countries are increasing their investments, particularly in HIV. And governments, not unwisely, are saying, well, we have a limited pool of money overall. If all of these external people want to invest in health, fine, we'll put our money in something else. And so it's replacing the government money rather than adding to the government money. And what's unknown, at least right now, is, so are governments taking the health money and saying, well, we'll invest in education, which I think we would all say, okay, that's great, or are they investing it in arms? Which we may say maybe not so great. So we don't really know what's happening with that replacement, but there is definitely replacement right now of funding going on globally. probably many of you are familiar with the Millennium Development Goals. The Millennium Development Goals, obviously, a concerted effort to address poverty around the world. And there are several health indicators. And as I mentioned, with very good reason, that there's this recognition that health is an important driver of economic development and poverty alleviation. So there are a few health-related indicators. And I wanted to highlight some of the progress that's being made in those indicators. And in large part, because of the increased overall financial pool, the really smart targeting of the poorest populations and those who have been left out of the story, like what happened in Kenya, this is not unique to Kenya. There's a real focus in the world of public health right now on trying to reach the unreachable or trying to reach the most remote areas. So what you can see is in terms of child mortality, this is between 1990 and 2000. I think it's just simply remarkable. This line on the other, this is sub-Saharan Africa. This change from 100, I think it's 181, to 129 deaths per 1,000 live births. So this is remarkable progress over a fairly limited amount of time through really targeted public health efforts and targeted investment. So also just demonstrating what can be done when that kind of focus is brought to an issue. This is looking at HIV, new HIV infections, and similarly top row, sub-Saharan Africa, which was worst hit by the epidemic. Just looking at what the prevention efforts, the antiretroviral treatment efforts have done for the epidemic in Africa, really reducing the level of new infections. All of this can contribute to really important economic indicators. So just turning the last couple of slides, I just wanted to turn a bit to Macalester and to what we're trying to do at Macalester College related to all of this. So I've put up what may be a very confusing slide just to describe what we see as the liberal arts process. So Macalester is a liberal arts college where we value first and foremost developing the critical thinking, the critical reasoning skills of the students by exposing them to a multidisciplinary approach. And so the students are kind of exposed to this liberal arts curriculum where they spend a lot of time writing, a lot of time thinking, and hopefully you're seeing the benefit of that as you get the Macalester students over here, because they really come out of that liberal arts curriculum able to tackle difficult issues by thinking about them from lots of different perspectives. And what we know from work on education development and how people learn is that people come in to a college like Macalester, or any of us sitting in this room, we have our own conceptual frameworks. We have our own preconceived notions. And then we get exposed to learning. And we can, different types of learning will change our perceptions, will change our conceptual frameworks. We'll start to think about things in a different way. And what we feel is really important at Macalester is if we're changing the students' thinking and we're changing their exposure and their information and their knowledge about global issues, we want them to get out there, not only build the foundation from an academic standpoint, but we want them to get out there and test their knowledge, test it. Like, is this real? Does this play out in the real world? So this is kind of what's highlighted down here. They get the skills, and they have the desire to explore if this is real, what they can contribute to a certain issue. And so Macalester and the Institute for Global Citizenship, the institute that I'm fortunate enough to lead, is where we try to find the opportunities to connect the students to the world through study away programs, through internship programs, through civic engagement opportunities. This is the place where they go out and test what they're learning and also bring back to college, bring back to their classmates, bring back to faculty, real world issues that perhaps are not being tackled sufficiently in the classroom. And all of this should change their preconceptions and their conceptual framework, and they just keep coming back for more study. And I think this is something for all of us to reflect upon, even though I can tell you with my degrees, I'm never going back, ever going back to I shouldn't say ever, but going back for another degree or a formal degree. But I do continue to learn. I want to continue to learn. So this is kind of a process that hopefully becomes a lifelong learning methodology for our students. So at the Institute, we really are engaged in trying to think about how to nourish not only our students, but the community of the Twin Cities and also where our students interact around the world in this continuum of learning. And so at the moment, we're undertaking kind of a fun activity that we're calling One Degree of Separation from Global Issues, where we're mapping the Macalester footprint on certain issues. And the first thing that we've been looking at is on food security. And so we've been looking at what are our faculty teaching on this issue? What papers are they writing? What are our students researching? What are they doing when they're out on internships? And importantly, what is our alumni network? How are they engaged in issues of food security? And we're doing this not just for the sake of kind of self-promotion. We're doing this because we really believe that there may be room for Macalester to engage more actively in projects around the world where we have an intellectual capital kind of comparative advantage to bring to the situation. So this is what we're working on right now, is to think about how we engage more actively in the community with the kind of Macalester community. We're also involved in a really interesting, heavily analytical project to look more in depth at these links between poverty, health, and development, but bringing in the other issues that I didn't even touch upon today, like the governance of countries, climate change, environmental issues, people's individual behavior, and trying to see if we can develop some analytical tools to support governments as they think about all of their issues on the whole, on aggregate. So we're involved in that. Macalester also hosts a task force for the World Health Organization looking at the impact of controlling neglected tropical disease on economies and education and social development. So in totality, we are just trying to complete this circle of learning and to make it available to our students and also the community at large, this notion of continual learning through practice and academic study. So thanks.
Thank you, Dean Hanson. As you know, learning happens when we ask questions. And it never happens when lecture. It's all about lecture. So please ask questions. All yours. Prone if you get the microphone from Stephen's side and then just ask.
Well, thank you so much for the presentation. If we could focus on just one thing, put all of our money and efforts in one thing to help Africa, what would it be?
Oh, I could not answer. This is what our great analytical tool will tell you. I actually think that one of the root causes, if you look at one of the fundamental root causes of almost all ill health, of poor learning, even when kids are enrolled in school, and of just overall constraint to economic growth, it's malnutrition. I think that the access to proper food and not just sufficient food, but nourishing food is really at the core of so many issues. So that's a complex, just saying, oh, we'll just tackle malnutrition is a massively complicated political and agricultural issue. But I think from my perspective, it's at the root of so many things that would be what I would say, feed everybody.
Hi, Gary Hesser from Augsburg College. Welcome to the other bank.
Thank you.
Because I just came back from Cuba with a group of students, and one of the things we were looking at was healthcare. And I think there's a question here. I wasn't checking my email, I was checking Wikipedia to see. I noticed that the TB rate in there is 7 per 100,000 compared to the over 300 that you showed there. It's my sense that over the course of time, Cuba has exported a lot of its healthcare professionals to various parts of Africa. Mm-hmm. Have you uncovered any connection or seen, especially when it comes back to the circle, of how do we institutionalize solutions? Have the Cubans been a part of any of these conversations, since they seem to live in their own world in so many different ways? Yeah. As you've been in and out of Africa yourself, is there any relationship whatsoever? Does that make sense?
Well,
either models of healthcare or development or...
So there are couple of comments that I can make on that. This is not an area that I study very much, but the Cuban health system, one of the ways that they've held down transmission of HIV and of also of tuberculosis, many people know, is through isolation. So when people are infectious, they implement kind of wards like we used to have in this country, a TB sanatorium where people would with tuberculosis would go off to the mountains to breathe the fresh air and not infect others. But in Cuba, there's a lot of isolation of patients to protect the population from that patient while the patient is being treated. And there are obviously true benefits to that because it does break the transmission, but there are a lot of kind of negative social ramifications of doing that. Now, it is only fairly recently, I would say over the last decade, that even in sub-Saharan Africa, tuberculosis, it is an infectious disease. It does take 6 months to treat. It's difficult to manage, even though we can cure virtually every case that's not multi-drug resistant or extensively resistant. It does take 6 months to treat. And it was the case that to ensure treatment, many, many countries, and given the rural nature of the populations, insisted on hospitalization of patients, which in effect is isolation from families and other. For at least the first 2 months of treatment. There's been a real push and a really positive push and a reason for a lot of the gains in TB that things could be decentralized to the community. People become non-infectious so quickly once they start antibiotic therapy that it's not really an enormous risk if we've got them on treatment. And they just do so much better if they're surrounded by their families and able to be at home for the treatment. So when it comes to the Cuban models, I think the rationale, the public health rationale for the way that they structure the system is clear. But there has been an evolution away from that model to more patient-centered models, at least in sub-Saharan Africa. Now, in terms of the export of the physicians, that is very valuable in contexts where there are simply not enough physicians or health workers, and they can be dispatched out. So. We have seen this in some places. The numbers are not, Cuba's a pretty small country, so even massive exports, when you spread them across the world, you don't just go in and say, oh, there are Cuban physicians everywhere. I've not seen that. I have run into them in some countries. So yes, it's an interesting dilemma for Cuba to lose their physicians and for them to possibly explore the evolution of their health system models. But for the moment, when you see the epidemiology, it works for them. But it's a difficult social issue.
If I may, I was struck at your model. My impression of visiting is the dispensary that every neighborhood in Cuba has a doctor servicing and accessible to 200 families,
right?
Which goes back to the beginning, not the
right.
treatment, but the identification. So I can't
right.
help but believe the
yeah,
critical
that,
thing that you
course.
Were pointing is even more central. Whether they're exporting that, it's how they've kept it down. At least my impression is even complementing mm-hmm. isolation, but they've identified it rapidly because mm-hmm. you have access by walking literally
yeah.
almost across yeah. the street.
Yeah, yeah. No, I'm sure that helps. And certainly as we see the diagnostic delay in other countries where there's kind of a pre and post, before the Cuba model and after, where you really bring in community health workers and decentralized care, the diagnostic delay gets cut dramatically. And so certainly that would be the case in Cuba. I would expect that you would have very minimal diagnostic delay with that model. Absolutely.
Matthew. My question goes back to the issue of funding substitution that's happening with a foreign aid coming in. Are there any safeguards in place or looking at any safeguards in the future of how it's dispensed? You said it was right now it's a demand driven. Will there be any prerequisites mm-hmm. if they have to spend a certain amount to address these same issues and anything along those lines as far as?
Yeah, no, that's a terrific question. The donors have long been worried about replacement, but this work being done by Health Metrics is really the first time that it's evidence-based on a large scale to demonstrate that there is this replacement effect going on. It's long been suspected. many donors, most donors, put into place policies, and we call it cost share. You know, that if funding comes in from a certain donor, there's an expectation and even sometimes a contractual requirement that for the donor money to continue to flow, that the government contribution would remain or would increase or all of this kind of thing. So those safeguards are very, very hard to monitor. And so they have been in place, but now that there are improvements in the monitoring of healthcare expenditures and of those budgets and this type of work, yes, it's getting much more on the radar screen of donors. The Global Fund, for example, is undergoing a massive reform right now. And one of the major points of the reform is around this issue of the government contribution. And they're looking at gradients. So depending on the GDP per capita, depending on the growth, depending on, it's a very complicated, elaborate matrix that I think is robust and well thought through, that considers the disease burden, the growth in the country, the GDP per capita, and kind of assigns an appropriate level of government contribution based on all of those factors. And then they are monitoring that government contribution. The other thing that's complicated about the monitoring the contribution is that so many countries have multiple donors acting at the same time and all with different ways of moving money and different flows and different accountability systems and all of this. So it's hard for any one donor to really understand the universe of funding and financing streams into a given country, because a government could potentially be taking one donor's money and saying and putting it through the government and saying that's our contribution. I mean, there can be a lot of mixing and mingling of funds if the donors don't collaborate and if they don't enable the government to truly lead the overall budget process with real transparency. So it is a really hard thing to monitor, but yes, it's absolutely on the forefront of most donors' agendas to enable the governments to lead that budgetary process while also being able to ensure that replacement doesn't happen, or that if donors are comfortable with it happening, that it's happening in a way that's supporting other social sectors. But I can tell you, it's very complicated to measure.
Thank you. Thank you, Dean Hanson. What I know is that normally people who do not want to be accountable, they say money is fungible.
Yes.
And we have no idea what your money did.
Yes.
But let me ask you a couple of questions quickly. And first, really, truly, welcome to Minnesota.
Thank you.
And Macalester is fantastic.
Thank
institution,
you.
Anya shows for us and other interns we had. And the education that they get is unbelievable. We don't want you to know that. And we are for the African diaspora and for, as you know, healthcare is a huge investment and it's a long term, it's mm-hmm. never it's short term. Mm-hmm. And we don't have a lot of money living in the United States. What would be the ways that the African community here in the state of Minnesota could be effectively helping whatever the country they're from, whether it's Kenya or Zambia or Somalia, it doesn't matter. How could you think mm-hmm. they will be at least impactful some of the health issues happening back there, the country of origin? And my also final, yeah, let me stop there, then I have one quick.
So I think that there are a couple of important levels. I think the first is that being resident in the United States, the African diaspora should be extremely vocal within the U.S. Congress, within the Minnesota state government, and within the U.S. Congress, about development assistance, what is needed at home, and the types of assistance and the structures of the assistance that you would like to see and that you believe would be helpful. Your counterparts back home don't have the same voice in the U.S. Congress that you have. So I think that is, from a macro level, a really important contribution that you can be making. And of course, Congress also has the ability to direct funds to certain countries. And I don't hope that you ever are, you know, lobbying just for your home country, but where there are, when you look at that development assistance per DALI and you see perhaps that your country has somehow not been considered, to dig into why and to encourage some dialogue on both sides to ensure a better match. So I think that you have a real voice in Congress. And the other way is to be thinking about your home institutions, your home infrastructure, your own community leaders, and be trying to educate, inform, and change the level of awareness and accountability at home through multiple levels, whatever are your networks, to be also encouraging the dialogue from that side moving up through policy.
Finally, Dean Hanson, as you've shown the case of Kenya, they have done something amazing in the grassroots level. And it took them about 10 years to understand it, do the analysis, investment, and the follow-up.
Right.
As far as you know, how are they sharing that information with the rest of Africa, specifically even the East Coast, of to transfer the knowledge and the systems so the people can, other countries can do it?
Yeah, thank you. That's a terrific question. In fact, this past year, there's some terrific leadership in Kenya, and they hosted for the first time a meeting, not of the high-level policymakers, but of people who work on TB, this case of TB, at regional and district level, sharing what they learned with a whole stretch of countries from East and Southern Africa, basically the SADC community. Mm-hmm. And so there is that exchange, that South-South exchange that is starting to happen, and I have to say it's so encouraging. SADC has a health desk now, so there's much more sharing of these kind of success stories and things happening through government, intra-government networks. So those are starting to happen through some of the economic communities, which is particularly encouraging. Of course, they also publish and this type of thing. But I think that those formal South-South exchange of lessons learned are really powerful.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Thank you for my thoughts on my questions. Any other questions? Seeing none, please, I have a couple of things for Dean Hanson. First and foremost, we really truly honored.
Thank you.
I knew really that you will make a connection about health and economic development, business and prosperity.
Thank you.
No, thank you so much. We assume that you drink coffee.
Oh, thank you. That's
this
very
is
nice. Thank you very much.
And this is whenever you can. This is the only time you would see the continent of Africa smaller
in
than
the
state
Minnesota.
Minnesota. That is the logo
thank
of the organization.
You. That's very nice.
This is our report and fact sheet about the organization.
Thank you so much.
No,
it was really a pleasure.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.